saw the cover of the Newsweek magazine that said something like, forget the church, follow Jesus, and it had a white man. So this is my liberating prayer, black people's prayer. Thou who art blacker than a trillion midnights, whose eyes shine brighter than a billion suns, thou whose hair doth coil tighter than a million springs, radiating all energy throughout the universe. We beseech thee, one and only one, to give us total strength to carry out thy will for the universe, to establish justice on planet Earth and live in peace. We are going to talk this evening with a focus on black male-female relationships. And I was deeply, deeply honored when I was signing the books. A couple came and said that I had saved their marriage. It will save the marriage.
That's right.
Because that is a force that they have in common, whether we think about it that way or not. Now, I have been talking about racism, white supremacy for 42 years. Now, I never thought that I would be focusing on a topic for that long. And when I first started talking, I thought, well, our problems as black people are going to be solved in a short period of time. But that's not the way things work, apparently. And you learn as you live. Now, we are in the midst of some very interesting times when we are experiencing the Trayvon Martin event. We are a few days away from the 44th anniversary of Dr. Martin Luther King's assassination. And these events tell us that the problem of racism, white supremacy, is still with us. Now, many times we try to forget about it and believe that, well, it's gone and we're post-racial. We have a black president and we're post-racial. But we are not post-racial. And anyone who feels moved by what has happened to the Martin family and what happened to Trayvon needs to dedicate him or herself to an in-depth understanding of racism, white supremacy, and that goes for all of the young men who have been killed. And it's our duty and our responsibility to understand why this is happening. You see, it is happening for a reason. And in medicine, we look for causes. In science, we look for it's not just the event, but what is causing the events to take place. Because when you understand why something is happening and what is causing events to take place, then you are in a position beyond just complaining. Now, I bought me a hoodie. I bought me a little hoodie that was on sale. But that's just like a surface sign. We have to go beyond the hoodies and understand why this particular thing is happening and why all of the things that black people are experiencing are happening to us. And to do that, we have to get into an understanding of this dynamic of racism and white supremacy. Everybody is familiar with his work. And Neely Fuller came along and said, the system is racism, white supremacy. Du Bois called it the color line. Neely Fuller says it's racism, white supremacy. And he said it functions in all areas of people activity. And I want everybody to understand this when they leave. He said the system functions where? In economics, education, entertainment, labor, law, politics, religion, sex, and war. See, religion, that's why you got a white image of God. You see, so that if we're people of color, we're worshiping the people that oppress us. But he said it's a whole system, and Neely Fuller helped me understand it's a system. And so as a psychiatrist, I said, well, why? Why would people set up a system like this on planet Earth? Why? See, like little children, 2 years old, they know how to start saying, why? Why? See, if people tell them to shut up, don't tell them to shut up. You might have to say, I don't know why. I don't know the answer, but the child is looking for cause and effect. They're looking to understand this world that they have been born into. So I said, why would a system of racism, white supremacy, be set up on planet Earth? Here's our planet. And I just thought about, you know, by the time you go to medical school and train in psychiatry, you've been in school a long time. In the course of being in school a long time, one of the things that I learned was that people who have white skin are a tiny minority. Now they call themselves majority and train us to call ourselves minorities. But that was a big deception. The people of color, the non-white people, are 9/10 majority on the planet. Now another deception was they told us that we were genetically inferior. But being trained in their medical schools and knowing about genetics, we are genetically dominant. Amen. That's why under white supremacy and under the brainwashing, even black people learn how to say, don't marry anybody darker than yourself. Because that dark is powerful. That's melanin pigment. And if you need to think about an example, just focus on President Barack Obama. His mother was white. His father was a black man. There's no way in the world that that would have produced those two people coming together could no way produce white, which is a genetic recessive trait. Black is a genetically dominant trait. And the darker you are, the more genetic power you have to produce this pigment. So the next thing we were taught, if you're black with a whole lot, get back. A little bit less if you're brown, stick around. If you're yellow, you're mellow. And if you're white, no pigment, you're all right. Now see, black people and people of color all over the world, I can go to London, England and say this, and everybody knows, if you're black, you're background, stick around, yellow, mellow, white, right? Because under white domination and under white supremacy, they taught us this by their behavior towards us, and programmed us to behave in that way in relationship to each other, and to begin to worship the fact that the grandmothers were raped. Are you all with me? Now, this is not for anybody to feel bad. But all of this instruction is based on maintaining this system of racism, white supremacy. And we need to understand that if I had Oprah Winfrey's money, I would get all of the crystal black people. And every year there would be a parade of the blackest people parading their beauty. Racism, the goal objective is white genetic survival on this planet. White genetic survival. Now, a lot of people say, oh, no, it's all about economics. No, they use these areas of activity to make certain that there's white genetic survival. They make the money and use the money and dispense the money for the purpose of the system. The same is the distribution of education for the maintenance of the system of their survival. All over Europe today, when they talk about Islam and checkmating immigration, they are really talking about the flood of non-white people coming into Europe from Africa and causing what? White genetic annihilation. You see, now mind you, they say they're going to do something about it. And how many people remember the case of the Norwegian man who killed nearly 70 people? And these were children of African and Asian ancestry who were in Norway. And he killed them because they were causing potentially white genetic annihilation. Now, they gave him a pass and said he had psychological problems. But he planned it well. He knew exactly what he wanted to do. And he carried it out. I say he wasn't mentally ill. He was engaging in white genetic survival by whatever necessary means. See, I say that standing your ground. Standing your ground, that means that, see, don't any black person attempt standing your ground. When they are killing other black people. Because that is assisting white genetic survival by the destruction of black men. So that's, you can get a pass with that. But don't start thinking you're afraid of a police officer and you're gonna stand your ground. You see, or that Trayvon could have stood his ground because he was afraid. No, those are the laws that are being put in place. It's just like when President Barack Obama became president. They had what they call the Obama effect. Now, the Obama effect was people buying more guns than had ever been bought at one time. Because just the very idea of a black man being in the White House was perceived as a threat. Just like the Republicans said, they didn't say we've got another plan to save the country. They said we have to make this black man fail. Our energy is going to be directed and focused on making him fail because he is a black man. Now let's go back about the relationship. Black females are not a threat to white genetic survival. Now we have all the genetic material in our ovaries, but women can entice, but they cannot impose sexual intercourse. In other words, imagine you reaching and pulling out your M16 rifle and saying to the man, you are going to have sexual intercourse. Now, gentlemen, what will happen? See, other words, racism, white supremacy attacks us as a total people for the purpose of white genetic survival. But the intense focus is on males because they can impose sexual intercourse. Now, all the different colors that we come in, most black families don't have two people that are the same color. Everybody's a different shade, yeah. And then that causes warfare in the family. Who's lightest? Who looks the most white? Speaking from my own family situation, everybody has color shade conflict. And it's not only in this area of the world, it's all over South America, all over Central America, all over India. See, who's dark and who's not dark? Who looks most white? And fight amongst yourselves. It's called divide and conquer. But all of those colors are because of the activity of white male oppressors and white slave masters. You see, it wasn't Sally Hemings in love with Thomas Jefferson. See, let's get that straight. See, that would be an absolute insult talking about the slave loves the master when the master won't free the slaves or the slaves' children. That's a fantasy. No, there was non-stop rape and sexual abuse on the plantations. See, I heard a white female talking about the plantation and her family, and she was saying that the slave masters would have relationships with the African women to make more slaves. Well, I guess that's part of it, aside from maybe whatever they might have enjoyed. But let's look at how this plays out. You see, because the system of racism is saying, and this is where I went in the ISIS papers into a discussion of the phrase motherfucker. See, this is a phrase that used to be said over and over again in the system of racism, white supremacy amongst black people. I remember coming out of a clinic in Washington, D.C., and I'm coming down the stairs and some young people were passing. And the young people were, motherfucker, this motherfucker, motherfucker, motherfucker. Girl was out. Black men died. baby. Are you all with me? Come on, because we're getting free. Black men call a woman they sleep with mama. How many? Y'all heard that? Hey, mama, can I ride with you? Calls a place where he sleeps a crib. Calls a woman he sleeps with mama. Calls a place where he sleeps a crib. Calls himself baby. Will call himself a motherfucker. Now don't get upset. See, in other words, we have to cease deceiving ourselves. We are living in a system of oppression. That's why things are falling all apart. That's why they can tell us that 70% of our households are single-parent households. Why? Because the system is making something happen. See, the system is making something happen, but the system says it is a democracy. Well, that's a hypocrisy. The system is racism, white supremacy that is perfected, not democracy with imperfections. See, this is why we are confused and why we greet each other all the time by saying, what's happening? Hey, what's happening? What's happening? Do you know what's happening? Hey, what's happening? A million times a day, what's happening? What's happening? Because we are into a deception and we don't understand what's going on. But we have to begin to understand exactly and specifically what is happening. Now, the reason that I said don't feel bad, but for us, black people, to stumble across this phrase, because baby compared to man is what? In power terms. Word is powerless. Baby compared to man is powerless. Now everybody comes from the continent of Africa. Human life began here. Black people were the first people, and I don't mean some higher monkey, were the mothers and fathers of everybody on the planet. Now, when white males have sexual relations with black women, they feel genetically powerless. Are you following me? And because we are their mothers, that's why they like the whole concept of mammy. They like to be fed by Uncle Ben and Aunt Jemima. See, that really was why Oprah had a whole lot of love. Because, honey, baby, tell mammy what's the matter. Albino mutants out. Garden of Eden, they ate the forbidden fruit and became ashamed of their nakedness. And they were chased out of the Garden of Eden. So those were the albino mutants that black people produced. And the black people, thousands of years ago, did the same thing with the albino mutants that they're doing today. Rejecting them. See how quiet it got. I told some white people in New Hampshire, whole audience of white people, I said, you know, maybe we owe you all an apology. Maybe we were the first abusing parents because we put you all as mutants out. And I thought they were going to start throwing their chairs. They sat just like little quiet mice. You see, and so what did they do? Time passes. We push them up into Africa, into Europe. You know, just look at your map. And right directly across from this big continent are these little tiny countries called Europe. And this is where the white people were pushed. But what did they do? They organized themselves, got in their boats, and came right back here and captured us and said, now, you all are going to take care of the white baby. You're going to put that black baby out in a box, nurse it when you can, but you're going to take care of us. So I'm saying slavery really was white people's reparations. Now see, if they buy that, then they got to buy that they're mutants. And we put them out. See, it's like after you function as a general psychiatrist and child psychiatrist for 40 years, and you see what the feelings are of children who have been abandoned. You see, that's one of the most painful things that can happen to a child. A child told me not long ago, nothing hurts more than that. See, nothing hurts more than that. We got to get that part together, too. You see, so we, you know, the person who was abandoned, Steve Jobs. You know Steve Jobs?
Yes.
One of the wealthiest people that the planet ever made. But he was angry because he had been given up for adoption. You see, he had all the money in the world, but people who knew him and were close to him, that he would break out in these angry episodes because he could not get over the fact that he was abandoned. So the white people have been beating us, whipping us, kicking us, raping us, doing everything conceivable to us. You see, but I want them to buy the whole package. Because we put them out as mutants, and that's why they have a glorified slave system where the children were shipped away from the parents. And now they got a glorified foster care system. Do you see, with books full of children. You know, do you want these? You think you want this? Think you want this one? You see, so this is a sick system. But, you know, we can put our shoulders back and say, okay, if we did this to you all, we're sorry. But you have created a horrific, unjust system. And since we are the parents of the planet, we're going to get it straight. See? You know, like if you were fortunate enough, in place. You know, they used to tell me when I was training in child psychiatry at Children's Hospital, they would say, Dr. Welsing can get all the children well. I mean, these little white children were running around spitting on people and chasing teachers out of the room. And I just, you know, brought my home training. We're not going to have that. And white people were saying, well, they've got to express themselves.
Genetic survival.
And now that black people and people of color are about to become the majority, then now they have to have stand your ground. See, if you come near me, if you frighten me, I have the right to kill at will. You see, which was the role of the police officer, they called it justifiable homicide. I thought he had a weapon. Well, gentlemen, you do. See, this is involved. If you read the ISIS papers, don't tell. The same brain computer will turn out specific balls. So what are the two series of ball games in the system of racism, white supremacy? Bring in the guns so that they kill each other want Tiger to come to my office. Tiger calls himself a cavalry agent. I mean, I'm not comfortable just being a black man. And so they got his mind kind of messed up. First of all those white ladies who were chasing him, apparently he was able to satisfy them. All the white men standing around angry. So he needs white people to like him. Tiger, I'm sorry, you know, tell me I'm wrong if I'm wrong. But he wants to be liked. Now he's the most powerful golf player in history. The best, even when he's behind, they say he's the best. So no, we can't have that. We can't have that. What is the game about anyway? What do white men say? White women say their ideal mate is tall, dark, and handsome. What do white men say? White men say they're not men until they've had sexual relations with a black woman. So now look at the game that the most powerful white men play. See, the presidents play golf. So a long stick like this. Trying to get the little white ball in a hole in Black Mother Earth. Now, Tiger got the race thing straight so he could stand up and be, look, I'm black. I'm not Cavalier Asian unless I put it on my head. I'm a black man. Let me be a proud black man. And let me get this stick working again. Do you all understand? It's a mental thing. But if he wants to be liked, and the white people are standing there in the gallery and all of his mates being angry with him because he performed better than they could perform. So they're angry, but if he needs their approval, and if he needs their love, and they're being angry with him, thinking negatively about him, then he cannot perform. Are you all with me? So what do we do? What do we do? Black male-female relationship. Why should there be a black male-female relationship? We don't ever ask ourselves that. Why should there be a black male-female relationship?
So we can have alliances against all the enemy.
See, people have to have a reason for what they do. Now, when we were enslaved, the slave master had a reason for the relationship. A stud and a breeder to make slaves for the plantation. The central focus was sex. The slave master wasn't trying to develop black people to the highest level of their genetic and constitutional potential. Slavery was a phase of racism and white supremacy. So we are supposed to not be enslaved. We're still subject to the system. Now, if black people don't have in their minds that the reason for the black man and black woman coming together is to make a strong race of black people that are going to go forth for 10,000 years into the future. You see, now that's the goal that's quite different than have sex. She don't get quiet. See, sex is wonderful. Sex is wonderful. But so what? See, we are in a war is being waged against us. And when people are fearful of their genetic annihilation, then the logical answer is to produce genocide. Destroy the genes of the people that you are afraid of. Destroy the people. If possible, turn the men into women. Turn the women into men. Bring their procreation to zero. Now, if the people don't understand what's happening, they'll say, fine, okay. There's an African proverb that says, monkey was so busy doing what everybody else was doing that one day, monkey cut his throat. See, in other words, monkey see, monkey do. If we don't have our own destination, if we don't have our own understanding of who we are supposed to be on this planet, I can see the Creator, he, she, whoever, sitting and say, I made you all the first people. You are the chosen people. I chose you, black people, to be the mothers and fathers of everybody on this planet. There's somebody in here who's a minister. There's a passage in the Bible that said the sons of God saw the daughters of man, and they were fair. The sons of God, the daughters of man are the mutations. And they were fair. Do you understand? Neely Fuller says, under the system of racism, white supremacy, when a black man is poor, he wants a job. When he gets a job, he wants luxuries. And when he gets luxuries, speak up, brothers. He wants a white woman. Now, the system has figured something out here. See, during formal enslavement, it was the white slave master raping the African woman, producing a mulatto, but the mother was black. So the first breast in the baby's mouth was black. Now they figured out, now what if we let enough of these white women loose? And say, sick 'em, Caroline. Then those little babies who have a white mother, they look black, but they have a white mother. And that will be their primary identification. And so we can use that group, whether they understand it or not, because there's major ambivalence. Can't go against mom. Are y'all with me? Now what do we do? Because I hear the Creator saying, I gave you everything to work with. So it's going to turn out that that melanin pigment that we have been taught to hate of those pyramids. But see, we have been taught to hate black people. You see, but the white people have an inkling about how important black is. Because when they want to be really dressed up, they don't put on white suits. Black, they'll even say black is the most sophisticated color. But we've taught them to not want to be black. But we try to paint ourselves. And if the suntanning color gets harmful, we'll tattoo ourselves. We'll put all that black ink. Now we got some brothers putting black ink on them. They already got the color. But it's monkey see, monkey do. So what are we going to do? See, what are we going to do? Our charge as the first people is to bring justice to this planet. Justice is not something that falls from the heavens. Justice is a byproduct of self-respect. Our self-respect has been taken down to zero. That's how come people can say, I'm a bitch and I'm a hoe. And I'm a dog and a bow wow. You see, in other words, see, we don't understand. We think, well, entertainment is over here. That doesn't have anything to do if I call myself a nigger. That doesn't have anything to do with anything. I'm a nigger. You're a bitch. You're a hoe. Girl saying, I'm a bitch. I'm a hoe. I'm a gangster. I'm a thug. Let's give them some more aid because they said we can get them to buy that because we're going to pay their so-called entertainers to pay them millions of dollars. Because they're carrying out psychological warfare against their people. But they don't understand. That's why they keep saying what's happening because they don't know what's going on. They don't know that the same force makes biological warfare. See, I say HIV is biological warfare until proven otherwise. See, they make biological warfare weapons. They make ethno-specific biological warfare weapons. That means that I can, you know, I can tell you, I want your genetic material to help you find who you were connected to in Africa. Then I take your sample and see what my weapon needs to be made. But they don't know because I've taught them to love white more than they love themselves. Do you all understand? So this is not about hating white people. It's not about being discourteous or disrespectful to white people. White people are saying, you know, they're the nicest, most polite, but it's something different about them. Something really different. I can't quite figure it out. They must be doing something. See, we need to get a hold of self-respect. Seek ye first the kingdom of self-respect. And you will be in the kingdom of God.
Amen.
I mean, imagine, we are made by the creative force. And then I'm going to say, I don't like being black. That's how I was made, but I don't like it. And then I'm going to call on that force to help me. and let's stop for the break.
Live right here in Baltimore. Can I tell everybody who you are?
I am Abundance Child, the autonomous goddess of Amexum. You already know who I am. I'm here at Francis Welsing event, Baltimore, already Tubman City. I'm here right here with B. Copeland.
From Michigan, that's what's good.
Yeah. So, yo, look forward to him on AmbundanceChild Internet Radio. That's blogtalkradio.com/AmbundanceChild. AmbundanceChild.com. Stop playing.
This is good. And you have something coming up with girls soon?
Oh, yeah.
Tell everybody about your movement and how to get in touch with you.
We got the Gaha Movement, GahaMovement.com. Going to be right here in Tubman City, May 20th.
They're not going overboard up to a point so that they produce a cadre of people who appear colored, but they will have ambivalence about themselves because they've got a parent. Now this wouldn't be a problem if you were not in a system of white supremacy. Do you see? So I would, as a psychiatrist, I would say any product of an interracial relationship, what color does the product want to be? See, they can be any shade of brown or yellow. But in a society that is dominated by white, that person is thinking, how come I couldn't have been all white? And when the white female, for example, says to that child, you're not black. So the man ought to pay attention because she's saying, I don't like black. So I tell the child, you're not black. But the child is going to be walking amongst all different kinds of people who classify themselves as white. And they're not looking at that child as other than black and treating them accordingly. So they're going to be confused and into self-hatred. I don't know, does that answer the question?
Also, I noticed there's a lack of
Well, in other words, let's say that, I don't know, do you come from the continent?
No.
Okay, but let's say that if people have been prevented, black people trying to do something, trying to get loans, trying to start businesses, and they keep running into no, keep running into no, keep running into no, then the person gets frustrated. You see, I had a man in my office who had developed a very successful business and then got a contract where he was going to get a sizable amount of money. And then he started being challenged, wait a minute, you should forget about the bid that you made. And then taking this person through all kind of hoops. And a man has to sit crying because he sees his business being destroyed. See, the question is, what do we run into? You see, and if you think you're in a democracy where things are supposed to be equal, now it's another thing if you know you're in a war. See, if black people were trained, you're in a war. You are not going to be, see, when I was going to school in Chicago, segregated schools south side of Chicago, the black teachers used to tell us, you got to be 10 times as good. Or you got to be 10 times as good. Now, they didn't go into my discussion of racism and white supremacy, but they were telling us something about the world that we were going to encounter. You see, but then when we got integrated, black people thought, now we're in. See, that's why black people in the beginning of the 20th century, when they knew that they were going to be discriminated against, started all kinds of businesses, even had their movie companies, because they knew they had to do it for themselves. You see, but oh, now we're integrated, so they're going to accept us. But no, they don't. And so then we're discouraged, are hating ourselves, drinking drugs and everything else. Do you see, well, how come they're not accepting me? And then I start hating myself and other black people. So no, if we start understanding we are in a local, national, global system of racism, white supremacy, and we are going to be blocked at every turn. But yes, look at the basketball players and the football players, you see, that are running against all kind of opposition. You tell them what the game is, and in spite of being blocked, they will reach a goal. You see, but when you, I don't know what it is. I would just say, see, and it's epidemic from what I hear people who are in schools. See, junior high schools and female children talking about they're going with each other with determination. You see, so I don't know what's causing it. I would just say, talking to the children, and you say, for people to survive, they have to have males, and they have to have females. And they have to be able to respect being females, and respect being males. Now, if that gets destroyed, the people can be destroyed. You see, so young people, I'm not certain what is causing you to feel this way. Maybe you can explain it to me. When did you decide about this? See, again, it's like, you know, all the discussion about is no fresh food in the areas where black people live. It's fast food. So somebody with wrong thinking can decide, well, we'll take over the franchises and we will fix the battery. See, in other words, like I say, as far as I'm concerned, HIV is biological warfare. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Anytime you can start out saying it comes from a green monkey and the Africans ate the green monkey and had sex with the green monkey, you're lying. Right. See, if you're lying, it means that you know the truth.
That's right.
And you see, so in other words, what is our fun? In other words, if we got in the position of respecting ourselves, just respecting ourselves and respecting our 500 years of history. You see, where it's been 500 years of mistreatment. You see, not by all different kinds of people, but by people who classify themselves as white. So if somebody, well, why would you say that? Well, we have to respect our history. See, nobody challenges Semites of the Jewish religion about respecting their history.
Come on.
You see, nobody is telling them they're supposed to love Germans. You see, so if we were in a self-respecting posture, we would have to say some strange things are happening to us. You see, and we can't explain it any more than the Semites of the Jewish religion could explain everything that people had set down and planned to put on them. They didn't find out until after it was all over. You see, well, we see something happening and we don't like it, and we have to look at your history as we are at this chessboard.
That's right.
Playing this chess game. You see, we do know that you are nervous about your genetic survival by any means necessary. You see, so we have to wonder, but I would just say calmly talk to the children. Don't shame them. Just say, if we are going to go forward as a people, we have to have people who are respecting being males and people who are respecting being females. That's the only way that we are going to continue ourselves 1,000 generations into the future.
True indeed.
Okay?
True indeed.
Like, what we have to reflect on is that we were enslaved for hundreds of years and we were being beaten. You see, and so that beating is silently being carried on. Now, we have oppressive conditions continually, so we have a lot of frustration. You see, that frustration feeds into black self-hate. It feeds into, a lot of times, men calling little children, you punk. You see, all of that. Just like we have epidemic levels of sexual abuse that we've got to be able to look at. And I say that goes all the way back to those hundreds of years of black people being sexually abused in the formal enslavement process. Right. You see, and we're talking about these things and reflecting on these things and respecting ourselves as we talk about it so that we can do differently. You see, it may be hard, but we can do differently. So thank you.
Peace and blessings, Mom. May I have permission to speak?
Go right.
Thank you. My name is Sister Victory Smith. Peace and blessings, family.
Peace.
I want to address the issue that Baba Nally Fuller Jr. stated, that because we are a diseased people under the oppression of white supremacy, that when we address each other, we should either address each other with something positive, or we should say absolutely nothing at all to each other. And that is on every level. Would you touch on that, please?
Well, maybe you can explain a little bit more about what you're saying.
He was saying because how we deal with each other, how we treat each other, the way we talk to each other, not just male and female, but how we deal with our children, and being under the oppression as a brother, explain his levels of depression and how he deals with his children in that aspect. And as Brother Daki said, that even us conscious people tend to sometimes speak badly and negatively of each other. And Baba Fuller said that because we are diseased and because we are under the umbrella of white supremacy, that we, in order to combat this oppression, to only speak positively when we speak to each other and have something focused to do when we are around each other. I.e. if we're just sitting around drinking, having a good time, usually a fight erupts or arguments erupts or gossip erupts, something destructive erupts because we're still in a disease, destructive state of mind. But if we come to each other and say, brother, what are you up to? And you say, well, I'm trying to do this, then we can come together because now we're on a mission. And we're doing something that has to do with uplifting our people. And when we're not doing that, then we should stay absolutely as far from each other as humanly possible.
Okay, Neil Fuller talks about no contact, no conflict, but this is why stop name calling each other, stop gossiping about each other, stop squabbling with each other, stop cursing one another, being discourteous and disrespectful, stop stealing from one another, stop robbing. See, that sounds simple, and so we just bypass it, but this is, again, what you are emphasizing. You see, if we had codification to undo the damage done by racism, white supremacy, so absolutely.
And I just also want to state that I work with 15 African young kings who are from, quote unquote, the hood, and I have found to the sisters who say, what do we do with the young brothers when they're out of control? We are nurturing mothers. We are nurturing mothers. We have the ability to love our young kings and talk to them as if we are preparing them for what they're destined for. And we love them and love them and respect them. No matter who us does not, we instill in them the power that they already have. We bring that to the level of consciousness. And I work with them every day, and I would trade for the world.
Third generation physician. My grandfather was a race man. You know, and this is kind of the tradition. My grandmother, his wife, he died in 1909, and my grandmother lived in our home when I'm growing up, and she would just say all the time, your grandfather was a race man. Mm. See, your grandfather was a race man. So all of us have that in our head.
Okay.
And my father and my mother, they were political.
Okay.
Do you see? So
I am am AmbundanceChild. I'm here with Dr. Francis Cress Welsing. This is the event that just happened here in Tubman City, Baltimore, at the Samuel Colders Elementary School. I would like to know, Dr. Welsing, what kind of movement, is there any movement that actually exists today? Like, we had the civil rights movement, we know about the UNIA, Pan-Africanist movement, things like that. Is there any type of movement that exists today for our people?
Well, I would say the movement that I think that we as black people need to be in and a part of is understanding racism, white supremacy as a total system construct.
Okay.
I mean, we're not moving with an analysis of the problem. And so therefore we go from event to event.
Okay.
You see one killing to the next killing, one to the next killing, and we protest. All of that is important, but for us to move forward, we have to take the analysis as to why it is happening and speak to that. Do you see? Not
yes.
be deterred by people who classify themselves as white saying you're playing the race card.
That's right.
See, the answer is the whole deck is race. Do you see? There's never been a point in our 500-year history in this area of the world when race, white supremacy, was not the problem.
That's right.
And so we are challenged. The movement, the goal objective, the agenda is to deal with the reality of racism, white supremacy as a system for white genetic survival, and that the goal objective being we are going to help replace the system of racism, white supremacy with a system of justice so there can be peace on the planet.
Excellent. Now, I understand that as an adult. I understand that as somebody who has read her book, The ISIS Papers. This is one of the first books that I read. I went to Clark Atlanta University. This book changed my life.
Okay.
It really did. I have two daughters. I would like to know, for the youth, what is something that you could tell somebody who's 16 and somebody that is 9, what they should be doing for race pride today?
Well, first of all, I think that children can understand that there is a problem of racism. People attempt to teach children and young children that because they are black, they are not beautiful. And that because they're black, they're second to somebody else. And so our message to children of very early ages is that you are black and you are beautiful and you are wonderful and you are part of the first people on the planet. And even though we have been oppressed as a people, we are going to use our creativity, our genius, and talent to correct the problem
right.
of racial injustice, racism, white supremacy on the planet. Do you see? And that's why we encourage our children to be smart and to learn and to take school seriously and plan to be in school for 25 years in making up their minds about what they're going to study and how they are going to contribute to our people. Like my parents raised us, you're going to go to college, but you are not going to college to escape your community. You're going to college so that you can learn and you can contribute to the problems that our people face.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
See, the message is clear. It's about uplifting humanity, not only for the adults, but also for the children. Go to college, get your education, whatever you have to do, make sure you bring it back home to the people. This is AmbundanceChild, Dr. Francis Cress Welsing. Thank you very much.
Let's get it popcorn. I got the Girl Scouts, right? You got your Girl Society.
Society.
Y'all got your own thing.
Girl Society, that's right.
You got your own thing called the Girl Society,
yes.
right? People donate to that, or how does that work?
They can go to girlsociety.org and they can donate, but mostly we are about economics and empowerment for our communities. So we have the girls selling the popcorn, selling the products, so that they can fund whatever their passions are.
That sounds like a winner right there. Once again, AmbundanceChild. One love. We live right here on StreetHype. We right here in Baltimore today. We got an author, a writer. Let's see what you got here right here, family. You know what I'm saying? That's what's good. Kind of explain your name right here. What's your name?
Ron Wills.
Ron Wills. What kind of books you got going on here?
These are my two books right here, Nice Guys and Players and Sexual Chemistry. They're both self-help books for men.
Mm.
I've been selling them for about 10 years. It's all about advice on what a man can do to develop himself optimally for women.
Mm.
Women have two sets of needs. They have a carnal need and they got spiritual needs. the ultimate man for him is a man who can satisfy both needs. That's what my books will do for you.
Okay, so you pretty much kind of tell a brother man how to love his woman properly, correct?
Yeah,
and exactly. Yours as well?
No, it's a friend of mine's, okay. Yana Yamache Morris. His book is The Oracle of Kim Sanu. That's a science fiction book, but it drops some knowledge in it.
Gotcha. So, you got some stuff over here. That's you too, right?
Yep, that's me and my wife on the cover. That's okay. Finding the right man. That's that's something for the ladies.
So for the ladies.
Oh yeah.
Okay. And then how about this one right here, though?
Oh, that's the same Copens, yeah.
What that's all about, fam?
That's a book. It's a science fiction book. It's another one of those books that has some knowledge in it, but it's presented in a science fiction format. Sometimes people can handle fiction better than they can handle reality.
But with the facts involved, is that what you're saying?
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly. We have one more book right here.
Yeah, this that's my called, sister right there. What's in my your aunt, womb? Aunt Makaru, What's in Your Womb? Basically, women out here, every single man they slept with is still with them, energetically in their womb. The sister tells you how to get rid of that energy, especially if that energy is negative.
Got you. Hey, where can they purchase any of this material right here? Some of your newest books?
Well, they can go to my books. They can go to my website. It's called naturalmating.blogspot.com.
Oh, natural mating?
Yes.
That's what's good.
Yes, .blogspot.com. So just hit me up there. You can get the books.
Okay, sound good, brother. You know what I'm saying? We're going to let you get back to business. Appreciate your time and interview.
All right.
Once again, what's his name? Ron?
Rom Wills.
Rom Wills. We'll see you around, brother.
All right.
One love.